Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Beyond Baseball's Color Barrier, the story of African Americans in Major League Baseball, past, present, and future, by Rocco Constantino. Narrated by Bill Andrew Quinn. Foreword. Luis Tiant. When I was a boy growing up in Havana, I remember baseball players coming around to visit my father, Luis Tiant Sr. Dad had spent more than 20 years as a pro pitcher, including many seasons in the Negro Leagues, and enjoyed seeing his old teammates, but he didn't want me following in his footsteps. He wanted me to finish school and become a doctor or lawyer. I didn't understand it at the time, but my father was trying to protect me from what he had gone through. It was tough for African Americans, Cubans, and other black ball players in the 1930s and 40s. Dad played year-round and was still never able to save much money. He and his Negro League teammates drove in broken-down buses from one town to another, and when they couldn't find restaurants or hotels that served blacks, which was a lot, they ate and slept on the bus. Some of them knew they were good enough to play in the majors, but this was before Jackie Robinson broke the color line. By the time he did, in 1947, Dad was too old to get his shot. But you know what? Even with all the racism they faced, Dad and the other great black ball players knew they were part of something special. Like Bob Feller and Ted Williams, they were the best in the world at what they did. They had loyal fans who packed ballparks to watch them, and they held their own against white big league clubs. They were poor, but they were proud. And in the end, my father saw I had the same love for the game that he did and gave me his blessing to follow my dreams. When I made it to the major leagues, I did it for both of us. That is what Rocco Constantino has captured so well in Beyond Baseball's Color Barrier, the tough times and great times black ball players had during the many long years they were kept out of the majors and their quick rise to the top when they got their chance. The early success of guys like Jackie and Larry Doby and Roy Campanella in the late 1940s and 50s made it possible for the second wave, Henry Aaron, Willie Mays, Roberto Clemente, Ernie Banks, and the rest, to come up behind them. By the time I played my first game in 1964, the All-Star teams were filled with players who 20 years before would have been riding the buses with my father. In 1975, when Dad saw me pitch in the World Series, African Americans made up 18.5% of all MLB players. Black ball players were constantly among the league leaders in batting, homers, and other stats, and superstars like Jim Rice and Reggie Jackson signed record contracts. They still faced racism, like when Aaron received all that hate mail when he was chasing Babe Ruth's record. But they made it to the top and served as inspiration for the next generation of stars like Ken Griffey Jr. and Frank Thomas. Now I worry things are going the other way. There are plenty of Dominicans and Cubans and other Latino players in the majors, which is great, but less than 7% of MLB players are African Americans. Dave Roberts was one of only two African American managers in 2020, and he won the World Series. What does that tell you? There should be more of them in the dugout and on the field. Baseball has gone from the game everybody played in the park after school to a specialized youth sport with expensive travel teams for the best players, most of them white. MLB is making an effort to reach out to young black kids through initiatives like the RBI program, and I hope it works. As Rocco shows so well in this book, African Americans have a rich legacy in the major leagues. For the sake of those who paved the way, and guys like my dad that never got the chance, that history needs and deserves to continue. Luis Tiant pitched in the major leagues from 1964 to 1982 and is considered one of the greatest Cuban-born baseball players of all time. A member of the Boston Red Sox Hall of Fame, Tiant is still hailed as a hero in Boston based on his 8 years with the Red Sox and his performance in the 1975 postseason. Introduction. The date is well known and revered annually throughout Major League Baseball. April 15, 1947, the day Jackie Robinson bounded out of the dugout at Ebbets Field for the first time as a Brooklyn Dodger. That event is celebrated as the moment Major League Baseball's color barrier was broken. It's considered a seminal moment in not only baseball history, but also American history. The truth is that the origins of African-American history in Major League Baseball are murkier than that, and the future may be even murkier. In a New York Times article on April 11, 1947, 4 days before Robinson's debut, a headline spanned the top of the entire sports page announcing, "Dodgers purchase Robinson, first Negro in modern Major League Baseball." The inclusion of the qualifier "modern" might seem suspicious to today's fan, but the article provides insight. The Times gives quick background on a player named Moses Fleetwood Walker, identified in the article as the last Negro to play in the majors. In 1884, Walker played one season for the Toledo Blue Stockings, where he was joined by his brother, Weldy, before the color line was drawn, not to be crossed by anyone again until that day in 1947. In 2004, research from Peter Morris, a member of the Society for American Baseball Research, SABR, S-A-B-R, shed light on William White, who was now recognized as the earliest known legal African-American Major League Baseball player. White played one game as a fill-in for the Providence Grays on June 21, 1879. White's story is complex, however. He has been confirmed as being the son of a white slave owner from Milner, Georgia, named Andrew White. William's mother was Hannah White, who has been listed on census reports as mulatto, making William one-quarter African-American, which, according to laws in most states at the time, meant that a person was legally black. This meant he would have had to abide by the separatist laws of the time. The issue concerning White is that he identified his race as white in the 1900 and 1910 census. Whether you can consider White the first African-American ball player is a matter of interpretation. Legally, yes, White is the earliest known African-American Major League Baseball player. Socially, however, White probably shouldn't be classified in that way. The day Robinson debuted was covered as a historic event, but it was not held in the same esteem as it is today. The Times article by Lewis Effort carried a bold headline and painted a picture of support, stating that "I'm for Robinson" buttons were sold outside Ebbets Field during the day's exhibition game. It mentioned that the Dodgers' Dixie Walker, someone who 2 years earlier said he would not play with Robinson and who was the most outspoken teammate against him during spring training, was roundly booed during batting practice and the game. However, the article also hinted at the vitriol Robinson could face. Effort wrote, "He may run into antipathy from Southerners who form about 60% of the league's playing strength. In fact, it is rumored that a number of Dodgers expressed themselves as unhappy at the possibility of having to play with Jackie." After Robinson debuted during the 1947 season with four other African-American players, the league slowly began to integrate. After no additional teams integrated in 1948, Monty Irvin debuted for the Giants in 1949, and as each year passed, the rest of the 16 teams slowly integrated. The Detroit Tigers, 1958, and Boston Red Sox, 1959, were the last two teams to integrate. In the 1959 season, the first year of full integration, 8.8% of players were African-American, according to research by SABR. Throughout the course of the initial integration process, multiple African-American players were making baseball history. The 1955 season was a monumental season that may well have catapulted Major League Baseball from the slow integration era into the boom in diversity of the 1960s and 1970s. In 1955, a 24-year-old Willie Mays followed up his Most Valuable Player MVP season from the year before by blasting 51 home runs and playing the flashiest stint at center field anyone had seen. In Brooklyn, the Dodgers were led by a trio of African-American legends as they captured an improbable World Series title. That year, Roy Campanella won the third of his MVP awards. Don Newcomb became the first African-American pitcher to win 20 games, and Jackie Robinson, then 36 years old, was still productive as the team's third baseman. In Chicago, Ernie Banks emerged as one of the great young superstars of the game. In his second season in 1955, Banks made his first All-Star game, belted 44 home runs, and drove in 117 runs while finishing third in MVP voting. Also making waves in the Midwest was a young Hank Aaron, who was a first-time All-Star at age 21 for the Milwaukee Braves that year. Frank Robinson debuted the next season for the Cincinnati Reds, winning the Rookie of the Year award. For the first time, baseball fans had an influx of young African-American superstars, as many of the African-American players who starred the 8 years prior were older veterans or part-timers. From 1960 to 1975, the percentage of African-American baseball players rose steadily to its peak in 1975 at 18.5%. The career of Mays ended in 1973, and Robinson and Aaron said goodbye in 1976. The torch was passed along to a succession of African-American superstars like Bob Gibson, Willie Stargell, Reggie Jackson, Billy Williams, and Joe Morgan. Just as the presence of African-American stars remained consistent, the overall percentage of African-American players in Major League Baseball was stable as well. From 1975 to 1994, the percentage of African-American players never swayed more than 1 percentage point from 17%. The success and popularity of African-American ballplayers from the 1950s through the 1970s buoyed the interest of young African-American baseball fans. They had someone to emulate in the streets while they played stickball. They had role models in Major League Baseball. Players who looked like them not only were among the best in the majors, but also were being talked about with the best to play the game. In 1974, when Hank Aaron passed Babe Ruth to claim the career home run title, the time had come for an African-American player to hold perhaps the most revered record in sports. The transition from Aaron and Mays to Reggie and Gibson coincided with the childhoods of such players as Ozzie Smith, Dave Winfield, Ricky Henderson, and Tony Gwynn. As fans can point to the 1955 season as a defining season in the path of African-American Major League Baseball history, data can point to the 1994 season as another watershed season. That season, the percentage of African-American baseball players was at 17.2%, its highest total since 1988. The league was again rife with young African-American stars like Barry Bonds, Frank Thomas, and Barry Larkin. Albert Bell was widely considered the game's most feared hitter, and Ken Griffey Jr. was a modern-day Willie Mays in center field. On August 11, 1994, Major League Baseball shut down for a 232-day player strike, the longest and most damaging strike in Major League history. Play resumed in late April 1995, and after a slightly abbreviated 1995 season concluded, 16.1% of the players who played that season were African American. It was the first time since Jackie Robinson's debut that the percentage of African American players in the major leagues dropped by more than 1% from 1 year to the next. From that point onward, the percentage of African-American players decreased in each season through 2010, when it stabilized at about 7%. In three of the four seasons between 2013 and 2016, that percentage dropped to 6.7%, the lowest number since 1957. In 1957, there were still two teams that had yet to integrate. The topic of the slow decline of African-American baseball players has been well-publicized and well-theorized during the past two decades. There is plenty of valid circumstantial evidence as to why this has happened. Theories include the rise in the percentage of Hispanic players, as high as 27.9% in 2006, the increase in popularity of the National Football League and National Basketball Association, the rising costs of playing the sport as a youth, and a generational culture shift. Even the expansion of roster spots taken up by pitchers plays a role. Traditionally, the percentage of African-American pitchers is much lower than that of position players, so as pitchers took up more real estate on major league rosters, one can surmise that may have influenced the drop in participation as well. Throughout the peaks and valleys of the past 7 decades of integrated Major League Baseball, there has been no shortage of role models and icons among African-American ballplayers. Jackie Robinson transcends the sport as a cultural giant in American history. Hank Aaron and Willie Mays do as well. Lou Brock and Ricky Henderson are the top two base stealers in the sport's history. Bob Gibson is one of the fiercest competitors to ever wear a Major League uniform, and few in the game's history could wield a bat like Tony Gwynn. Ken Griffey Jr. is among the most graceful ballplayers to play the sport, and few players or managers have commanded respect the way Frank Robinson did. While the accomplishments of those Inner Circle Hall of Famers speak for themselves, there is also a litany of other African-American players who have had fantastic seasons, accomplishments, and careers. Vida Blue had one of the great pitching seasons in baseball history as a 21-year-old in 1971. The baseball world didn't see another season like that until Dwight Gooden's historic 1985 season. When Cecil Fielder cracked 51 home runs in 1990, he broke a streak of 13 seasons without a 50-homer player, the longest such drought in Major League history. The beloved Roy Campanella is known for his 3 MVP seasons, but also still holds the highest career caught stealing percentage of any catcher in Major League history at 57%. Curt Flood was a Gold Glove center fielder, but his bigger impact came when he sacrificed his career to challenge the reserve clause in 1969. Major League Baseball has been around for more than 150 years, and as the sport expands globally, the impact African-American ballplayers have had stretches far and wide. It hasn't been just the names in the record books who have blazed a trail through the sport. It was Pumpsy Green finally integrating the Red Sox, Joe Morgan's elbow flap, and Billy Williams' sweet swing in Chicago. It was Dave Stewart glaring at the batter who dared to stand in the box, and Vada Pinson gliding around the outfield at Crossley Field. It was Oscar Gamble's afro, Dave Parker's cannon, Bo Jackson breaking a bat over his knee, and Dick Allen blasting obscene home runs and lighting up cigarettes in the dugout. It was Mookie Wilson's ground ball in the 1986 World Series, and Mookie Betts' heroics in the 2018 World Series. It was Dominique Smith speaking emotionally, tears streaming down his face during the racial unrest in the summer of 2020. It's Dave Roberts becoming the first African-American manager in National League history to win a World Series behind the leadership of Mookie Betts. It's Blue Moon, Mudcat, Oil Can, Bo Nose, and The Big Hurt. Baseball may have been widely popular in the first half of the 20th century, but it truly gained its flair in the post-World War II era. Think Jackie Robinson dancing off third base, ready to steal home. Satchel Paige bringing his trouble ball to the Indians. Willie Stargell whirling his bat. And Reggie Jackson stirring the drink. The flair was Gary Sheffield menacingly waving his bat, Daryl Strawberry's moonshot home runs, and Josh Harrison wiggling out of another rundown. If you are someone who remembers those images, chances are you're smiling as big as Curtis Granderson or Kirby Puckett. While the percentage of African-American ballplayers may have steadily decreased in the past 20 years, the impact they have made on the game has not. But before all of that was possible, there was Will White, Moses Fleetwood Walker, and the subsequent rift that divided baseball along the color line for more than 60 years. 1. Drawing the Line. Fleet Walker and the Curious Case of Will White. Column 3 on page 7 of the June 22, 1879 edition of the Chicago Tribune offers insight into the racist language that was acceptable at the time, while also verifying that the idea of baseball superstitions extended back to the game's early beginnings. In a collection of unrelated anecdotes appearing under the simple heading Notes of the Game, a short story tells the tale of Jack Burdock, a second baseman for the Boston Redcaps. On his way to a game against the Cincinnati Reds, Burdock spotted a cross-eyed woman in a window, and after the Redcaps lost, he declared that a hex was put on the team by the woman. The article continues, "On the first day they played here, a little Negro boy rode all the way out to the grounds on the rear steps of the bandwagon containing the team and returned to the city in the same way. As the Bostons won a victory, Charlie Jones pronounced the boy a lucky coon and named him. He paid the little snowball $0.50 and secured from him a pledge to be around at Gibson House on the following day at 1 o'clock for another ride. The promise was kept, and another victory resulted. On Saturday, there was no coon, and defeat followed." The language used in the article in one of the most prestigious newspapers in the country is striking by today's standards, even if it was standard during that era. While it exemplifies normative language of the 1800s, it doesn't carry any historical weight. A brief mention in column 1 on the same page about a ball player in a game between the Providence Grays and Cleveland Blues does, however. The article mentions that veteran first baseman Joe Start took a leave from his team and was replaced for that game by a man named William White, a member of the Brown University baseball team. According to the article, White played the position with remarkable activity and skill for an amateur. He also scored a run later in the game. White never appeared in another major league game and would rest in baseball history as a forgotten footnote for the next 130 years. In 2004, as part of a larger-scale project to find accurate personal information for every single person who appeared in a major league baseball game, researchers stumbled upon the idea that White might have been the first African-American professional baseball player. The National League was just 3 years old at the time, and although there are records of baseball games involving African Americans and white players, there had been no known black Major League Baseball players to that date. When researching White's information, researcher Bruce Allardyce emailed Society for American Baseball Research biographical researcher Peter Morris, alerting him to the possibility of White's racial makeup. Allardyce found that an Andrew A.J. White lived in Milner, Georgia, where he owned 70 slaves. The 1860 census listed no children or wife for White. 10 years later, the next census listed a woman named Hannah White, who was living with her mother and three children, one of them a 9-year-old named William White. Hannah was listed as biracial on the census. That led researchers on a quest to convincingly link Hannah and William White to A.J. White, confirming William's parentage. That objective was realized when reading A.J. White's will. In it, he bequeathed his entire estate to William Edward White, Anna Nora White, and Sarah Adelaide White, the children of my servant, Hannah. According to racial classifications of the time, William was considered a quadroon, someone who was one-quarter black. Complicating things, however, was that William identified himself as a white male on multiple census reports. Calling White the first African-American baseball player may be accurate based on laws of the time, but socially it's difficult to make that distinction. There is one missing piece of the puzzle that could cement this case further. According to the Chicago Tribune article, White played well in the game, and it is known that Joe Smart, the man he filled in for, missed a significant amount of time. The next game was 3 days later in Boston, and White did not play for the team. A plausible theory is that White's lineage was discovered, and he wasn't permitted to play anymore. For now, that is just one unconfirmed theory among others. In 1908, African-American player and scholar Moses Fleetwood Walker authored a pamphlet titled Our Home Colony. In it, Walker traces African-American history to that point with the ultimate thesis that African-American people should consider returning to Africa to populate a colony of their own. Walker wrote, "What Negro parent can have the audacity to hold up before his beloved son the possibility of ever becoming president of the United States, or even a United States senator? If his son is mechanically inclined, how can he stimulate and satisfy his ambition by promising to place him in any of the great machine shops of the land, or on a locomotive engine on the numerous railroads of the country?" In writing about the lack of opportunities for societal advancement among African Americans, Walker failed to include the profession of Major League Baseball player. It is a topic that he would have been fully qualified to speak on, as it was Walker, not Jackie Robinson, who was the first African American to openly play in the major leagues. Unlike William White, who lived his life as a white man, Walker did not and could not hide his identity. White's complexion and 75% white parentage gave him the opportunity to claim to be white in social situations, even if he was considered African American by law. Walker also was of mixed race, but his dark complexion left no doubt that he was a black man. So, when Walker and his brother Weldy played for the Toledo Blue Stockings of the American Association in 1884, they became the first players to openly embrace their African heritage as Major League Baseball players. The opportunity almost never came to pass, as a year earlier, Walker was the target of the supremely talented but viciously racist Hall of Famer Cap Anson. Anson's Chicago White Stockings team was scheduled to play an exhibition game against Walker's Toledo team on August 10, 1883. Walker was a star catcher, known for his excellent defense behind the plate and adequate offensive game. In March of that year, a motion was presented to the executive committee of the Northwestern League by a member of Peoria's team to bar African American players from the league. The motion was voted down, allowing Walker and a small handful of other African-American men to play in the league. By the time Walker's squad was set to face off against Anson's team, the Chicago Star tried to take a stand. As was typical of catchers of the time who did not wear a glove, Walker had a sore catching hand, and it is believed that Toledo manager Charlie Morton didn't want Walker to catch in an exhibition with a hand injury. Morton allegedly planned on holding him out of the game. Anson did not know this and protested Walker's place in the game. After learning of this, Morton entered Walker into the starting lineup in center field as a means of protest against Anson. The game was delayed for an hour while Anson and Morton argued about Walker's participation. Eventually, Morton declared that if the game was canceled, Anson's team would forfeit their share of the game's gate. With no way around this, Anson ordered his team to the field and competed against Morton's Toledo squad. The incident was well documented in the Toledo Daily Blade and painted a picture of acrimony in Anson. The article also celebrates Morton's stand and notes that Walker had the support of the people of Toledo as well. This incident happened less than 20 years after the end of the Civil War and showed the respect Walker carried among those who were familiar with him. However, Anson's stature in the game carried tremendous weight, and he had the support of many. In 1884, Toledo and Chicago were set to play again. By this time, Toledo had joined the American Association, which was considered a major league at the time. For this game, Anson demanded advanced notice that Walker would not play in the game. Walker didn't play in the game, allegedly due to injury. He was plagued by injuries in 1884, his only season in the majors, and he hadn't played the three previous games, so it is not out of the question that this injury was legitimate. However, it is also plausible that pressure from Anson kept him out of the game, even though the defiant Morton was still manager of Toledo. Walker played in 42 of the team's 104 games in 1884, and his brother appeared in 5 games that season. The White Stockings disbanded after that season, and Walker never had another chance to play in the majors, taking a job as a mail carrier instead. Anson's influence on baseball segregation has been debated. There is no question he refused to play against African Americans multiple times, and there are written accounts of him using horrendously racist epithets. The debate lies in just how influential Anson was. There are no accounts of leaders citing Anson as their motivation for segregation. While he was undoubtedly an influential player-manager, the real power and fault in the segregation of the International League lies with the owners. After the incidents between Anson and Walker's teams in 1883 and 1884, participation of African Americans in the high minor leagues actually increased. While there were no additional African-American players in the majors after Walker, there were 7 African-Americans playing in the International League, which was the highest level of minor league baseball at the time. On July 14, 1887, in the face of growing numbers of African-Americans playing, owners of the teams in the International League brought forth a vote on the future of integrated baseball. The owners voted 6-4 to ban future contracts for African-American players in their league. The 6 teams who were all white were the ones to approve the measure, while the integrated teams all voted against it. African-American players like Frank Grant, George Stovey, Bob Higgins, and Walker were allowed to remain, but no new players could be signed. Although the vote was not part of recorded league business, it existed as a gentleman's agreement from that point onward. Other high-level leagues and the major leagues followed suit, and a segregation line was drawn, informally on record, but steadfast in practice. Baseball's White Era. The Syracuse Stars were a fledgling team in the International League in 1887 when management attempted a bold move to boost the team's production. Ownership signed 7 players from the Southern League, which had folded after the 1886 season. The group of Southerners and their racial prejudices made the trip north, and while it may have seemed like a good plan to infuse the team with new talent, it ended up drawing a deep divide within the roster. The former Southern League players banded together to influence who would manage the team before the season started, and when the games began, the Southerners sabotaged the performances of players who were not part of their group. The team atmosphere was so toxic that manager Jim Gifford resigned on May 17th to be replaced by Ice Water Joe Simmons. Simmons had managed current Syracuse player Fleet Walker the year before in Waterbury and was familiar with many talented African-American ballplayers who many teams wouldn't consider signing. In an attempt to bolster his roster, Simmons' first move was to sign Robert Higgins, a left-handed African-American pitcher who was 19 years old. Not only was Higgins a talented pitcher, but also he was promoted as an adept hitter and speedy base runner. Considering the rift already in place and the large influx of Southerners on the team, it's no surprise that this move was akin to throwing a lit match into a powder keg. In Higgins' first start, the Southern players on the Stars intentionally botched numerous plays throughout the game to make him look bad. The Stars lost 28-8, with 21 of the runs being unearned. Coverage of the game was plentiful considering the era, and publications castigated the Stars for their play behind Higgins. The Toronto World newspaper ran a headline that simply read, "Disgraceful Baseball," and Sporting News ran an article under the headline, "The Syracuse Plotters, the Star Team Broken Up by a Multitude of Cliques. The Southern Boys Refused to Support the Colored Pitcher." A Syracuse reporter even went as far as to call the Southern League players the Ku Klux Coterie. Whether it was the well-earned backlash from the media and fans or the stewardship of Joe Simmons, the subsequent games in which Higgins pitched were played squarely. The next problem came when the Stars were set to take their team picture. Many players bristled at the idea of being in the team photo with Higgins, but almost everyone lined up for the photo anyway. 2 players, Henry Simon and Doug Crothers, flatly refused to be in the team photo, leading to a physical altercation in which Crothers punched his manager. The team photo incident was also covered by the media, and Crothers attempted to explain himself in an interview. Crothers said, "I don't know as people in the North can appreciate my feelings on the subject. I am a Southerner by birth, and I tell you I would have my heart cut out before I would consent to have my picture in the group. I could tell you a very sad story of injuries done my family, but it is personal history. My father would have kicked me out of the house had I allowed my picture to be taken in that group." Crothers was initially suspended for the season, reinstated 2 weeks later, and then ultimately released 2 weeks after that. Simon faced no punishment for refusing to sit in the team photo, partially because he was one of their top players and also because he did not punch his manager. While the Stars were drowning in controversy in 1887, the Newark Little Giants were dominating the International League thanks in large part to pitcher George Stovey and catcher Fleet Walker. Although professional baseball was two decades old, Walker and Stovey comprised the first African-American battery in professional baseball history. The Little Giants won the International League title in 1887 on the strength of Walker's leadership and Stovey's masterful season, in which he went 35-14, sometimes debated as 33 or 34 wins, with a 2.46 ERA. Still reeling from the mess of the 1887 season, the Stars hired Charlie Hackett away from the Little Giants to manage them in 1888. Despite the racial unrest, Higgins was asked back to the Stars in 1888, and in an attempt to protect and mentor the young Higgins, Hackett brought the respected Walker over to the Stars from the Little Giants. Walker's presence and popularity with fans helped subdue the outward racial hatred of his teammate, but it did not fully eradicate it. Despite going 17-7 in 23 starts, reported in 1888 by Sporting Life as 20-7 through the first half of the 1888 season, Higgins eventually tired of the racial strife and left professional baseball altogether before the season ended. Walker remained and helped the Stars to the International League title. Walker returned in 1889 and had built up a fantastic reputation in the town and among fans. He served as a team spokesman and leader, and was a popular figure in the Syracuse business community. His play on the field was not up to his typical standard, however, and Walker was released on August 23, 1889. No African American would appear in an International League game again until a 27-year-old Jackie Robinson joined the Montreal Royals in 1946 after batting .414 for the Kansas City Monarchs of the Negro Leagues the season before. Blurred Lines. By all accounts, Charlie Tukahoma was an outstanding ball player who played at the turn of the 20th century. In fact, some opined he was one of the best of his era. He was a well-rounded second baseman and a deft base runner, and had the leadership acumen to be named team captain on one of his teams. He even led his 1896 squad to a championship. The reason he is a nearly unknown blip in baseball history is that Tukahoma only existed for a short period of time. In actuality, Charlie Tukahoma was Charlie Grant, star second baseman for the Columbia Giants, a professional all-black baseball team that predated the Negro Leagues. But briefly in 1901, Grant was on the cusp of becoming the first African-American baseball player to break the understood color barrier of Major League Baseball. Prior to a 30-year stint as manager of the New York Giants that would land him in the Hall of Fame, John McGraw helmed the Baltimore Orioles for two seasons in the newly formed American League. It was during that time that the first documented interaction between McGraw and Grant occurred. There is plenty of conjecture about how Grant and McGraw became acquainted. Grant was the star of a popular barnstorming team in the late 1800s and a well-known player in those circles. McGraw could have known him from those games and conceivably even played against him. Hall of Fame player-manager Clark Griffith could have also played a role. He was a player for the Chicago Colts and Chicago Orphans during the same time when Grant was starring for the Columbia Giants in Chicago. It is well documented that Griffith attended many all-black baseball games and was likely very familiar with Grant. It is also known that Griffith was in Hot Springs, Arkansas, at the same time as McGraw and Grant when the plan was hatched. The logical explanation could be that some pre-existing relationship or knowledge brought McGraw and Grant together, and that Griffith, at a minimum, had knowledge of the situation. Famed sports columnist Bill Bryson Sr. relayed a folksier story of Grant and McGraw in his column in the Des Moines Tribune on July 6, 1962. Allegedly, McGraw traveled to Hot Springs to scout potential baseball players when he saw a group of African-American men playing baseball. The group consisted of employees of the Eastman Hotel, and Grant was among them. McGraw was widely known as a person who would bend, if not break, baseball rules, and he used his expertise in finding loopholes to try to get Grant onto his team. The story goes that McGraw knew Grant had the talent to play in the majors and met with him in the Eastman Hotel lobby. McGraw told Grant that he wanted to sign him for his team, but African-American players weren't allowed in Major League Baseball. At some point in that lobby, McGraw was looking at a map and noticed the Tuckahoma Creek, a name with a clear Native American etymology. McGraw then decided that Charlie Grant, the great African-American second baseman, would become Charlie Tuckahoma, the mysterious Native American ballplayer. Although African-American players were banned from playing in the major leagues, Native Americans were not. Louis Sakalexis, a Penobscot Indian from Maine, was teammates with Cy Young and the Cleveland Spiders from 1897 to 1899, and although he faced discrimination, American Indians were not outwardly banned the way African Americans were. In fact, Sakalexis was a celebrated athlete who did nothing to hide his American Indian heritage. McGraw figured that Grant's lighter complexion and straight hair could help in passing him off as a Native American, and the two moved forward with their plan. Dave Wyatt, another African-American ballplayer, later worked as a sports writer and claims the idea of Tuckahoma originated with him. Wyatt knew McGraw and Griffith, and in an article he wrote in the Indianapolis Freedom on February 19, 1910, Wyatt claimed he approached one or both of the men with the idea of passing off Grant as an American Indian to get him into the major leagues. Wyatt also cautioned that many major leaguers, including influential Hall of Famer Roger Bresnahan, knew exactly who Grant was, so it would be difficult to pull off. Wyatt wrote, "Grant was one of our greatest baseball players. Some years ago, he accompanied the writer Wyatt to Hot Springs, where we hatched a plan to better the condition of colored players. I placed the same before McGraw, whom I knew personally. We manufactured a name, Grant a Muskogee." According to Wyatt, however, a different newspaper reporter heard of the plan to sign the mysterious American Indian superstar and reported his name was Tuckahoma. If Wyatt's version is to be believed, the reporter overheard a conversation about the plan of a player named Grant a Muskogee from Tuckahoma, mistook his name as Tuckahoma, and ran with the story. Whatever the origin was, the subsequent details are a little clearer. McGraw signed Grant and billed him as a full-blooded Cherokee Indian from Oklahoma. The signing was well publicized for the time and drew the attention of fellow major league managers and administrators. McGraw moved forward, and word spread about Grant. The Baltimore Sun mentioned Grant in an article on March 10, 1901, just 6 weeks before opening day. The article focused on the brooding conflict between the American League and National League before they were combined to form the major leagues. The article segued into a discussion about the Orioles preparing for the season. It mentioned that team captain Wilbert Robinson and some players were working out at Johns Hopkins to prepare for the season, to be informed to keep pace with the manager, McGraw, when he appears with the Cherokee Indian player Grant. 2 weeks later, the St. Louis Post-Dispatch mentioned Tuckahoma again, this time in more detail. In an article under the header, Current Sporting Comment, Tuckahoma is referenced as a utility man signed by the impresario McGraw for his Baltimore American club. The article continued, "He is an Indian whose previous career on the diamond is not familiar to St. Louis fans." The article theorized that Tuckahoma may be used as a utility man, but also speculated another use for Tuckahoma that painted a picture of the cartoonish ways Native Americans were viewed during that time. The article suggested that Tuckahoma would possibly do war dance stunts on the baselines when his fiery little chief, McGraw, who was player manager at the time, is at the bat or on the bases. This didn't seem to be a tongue-in-cheek suggestion either, as the paragraph ended by intimating that Tuckahoma could fill the interesting role of mascot. The article continued and drew parallels between Tuckahoma and Sakalexis, who had been out of baseball for 2 years at that point. The interesting part is that there was no hint whatsoever that this was all a ruse. The Post-Dispatch article imagined Tokahoma's popularity among fans and compared his potential to that shown by Sakalexis during his short career. But whatever his part, he is destined to become conspicuous in the baseball world if he holds his job. The small boys in the bleachers will at once develop a particularly friendly interest in him, call him Tukey Old Boy, and direct him every time he steps to the plate to make a homer. For the sake of other noble red men who contemplate deserting the reservation for the ballpark, his tribe earnestly hopes that Tokahoma will eschew the picturesque precedent set by that other famous Indian, Sakalexis. Tebow trotted out that reformed man of the blanket and head feathers as right fielder on his star Cleveland team, and for a time he threatened to put Willie Keeler and others out of business. But Firewater was his undoing, and Sox has been permanently wiped off the baseball map. As far as records show, the scheme lasted a few more days before suspicions were raised, most notably by Charles Comiskey, the Hall of Fame owner of the Chicago White Sox. On March 30th, the Topeka State Journal reported that Comiskey claimed that Indian Grant was African-American. Grant still tried to play along, however. According to the article, Grant insisted that his mother was a Cherokee Indian and his father a white man. He said his mother lived in Lawrence, Kansas, and that McGraw can get proof that he is Indian and white bred. The article concluded by declaring that Tokahoma was set to play second base on opening day, which was now less than 3 weeks away. Whether it was Comiskey's charges, Clark Griffith's probable knowledge of the situation, or, as Dave Wyatt claimed, the idea that many major leaguers already knew of Grant based on his play for the Columbia Giants, McGraw relented and didn't include Tokahoma on his opening day roster. However, it appears that McGraw had a change of heart a month later. On May 20th, the Baltimore Sun interestingly reported that Charlie Grant had been ordered by McGraw to report to Boston, where Baltimore had been playing a series against Cy Young and the Boston Americans. This time, however, there was no attempt to masquerade Grant as Native American. The press release was straightforward, casually mentioning his fleeting identity as Tokahoma, but didn't reference any controversy about McGraw adding an African American to his roster. The release did say there was an ongoing discussion as to whether Grant was Native American or African American. The exact date of the transaction isn't known, but circumstances related to Baltimore's game against Boston on May 17th could have provided a clue. While Baltimore was in Boston, American League President Ben Johnson issued a suspension of McGraw for 5 games. In the previous series against the Philadelphia Athletics, McGraw argued vehemently with umpire John Haskell. Some accounts said that McGraw tried to stamp on the umpire's feet, causing McGraw, who was the team's starting third baseman, to get tossed from the game. 2 innings later, Baltimore catcher Crazy Schmidt was ejected by Haskell, causing McGraw to return to berate Haskell once again. It was after McGraw's suspension that the Orioles attempted to sign Grant, most likely as McGraw's replacement. Grant never did officially report to the Orioles. There are no records as to what kept Grant from replacing McGraw in the lineup, but one can surmise the league put an end to that idea just about as quickly as it was hatched. The bizarre plans to have Grant play for the Orioles on 2 separate occasions possibly marks the closest any African-American ballplayer came to appearing in the major leagues in the decades between Moses Fleetwood Walker and Jackie Robinson. That is, unless you believe claims that some African-American players were snuck into the league under the guise of being Cubans. Baseball in Cuba is said to date back to at least the 1860s and has remained a passion among Cubans ever since. The United States and Cuba have had a reciprocal baseball relationship dating as far back as 1899. John McGraw frequently visited Cuba while scouting, and many American professionals played winter ball in Cuba since the advent of the major leagues. The first documented Cuban to play professional ball in the United States was Esteban Bayon, who played for the Troy Haymakers in the National Association, the precursor to the National League, in 1871 and 1872, well before the color line was drawn. The color line wasn't so much broken in one fell swoop by Jackie Robinson. More accurately, it was eroded away in the years before Robinson shattered it for good. Pitcher Luis Padron was asked to try out for the Chicago White Sox in 1909, and that was where the lines started to blur. The complexities involving racial heritage in the United States and Cuba were inconsistent, so ballplayers fell into different categories depending on where they were playing. In the United States, players were categorized by what was colloquially known as the one-drop rule, which stated that if there was any African-American ancestry in a person's lineage, a person was considered African-American. One drop referred to the idea that if a person had one drop of African-American blood, he or she should be considered African-American, no matter how light or dark that person's skin was. In Cuba, however, they used a spectrum, as people fell into different racial classifications based on skin color. So, a person in Cuba with African ancestry and light skin was treated differently than a person with African ancestry and dark skin. The big difference in baseball in the two countries when it came to race was that in early Cuban baseball, every race were permitted to play professional ball, while African Americans were barred from playing amateur ball. In the United States, when the color line was drawn, if a person had any African ancestry, they could not play. That started to change when Cubans and Latin Americans began to get opportunities in the majors. Participation rules started to change, and the color of a player's skin started to play a role, in addition to his ancestry. Padron was a light-skinned left-handed pitcher who could also play the outfield. He is a member of the Cuban Baseball Hall of Fame and was well known during his playing days, but his potential track to the major leagues is unclear and inconsistent. At the very least, it is known that Padron played for the New Britain Baseball Club in 1908. An article from the Springfield Republican from July 24, 1908, gives some insight into Padron's case, but also that the idea of color line was still on the collective minds of the baseball world. The seemingly innocuous resignation of the Connecticut League treasurer prompted coverage by the Springfield Republican, and while that was the focus of the story, it was the fallout of that resignation that is important to historians. The article announced that P.H. Prindeville resigned from his position and would be replaced.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.